Hello, we're back.
We're back.
One day, I'm going to get this right, and it's going to shock us all. Hello, we're back. It's the Obligatory Podcast with Kermit and Mike, coming to you live from the Orlando Improv at Beautiful Point, Orlando. I'm Mike.
And I'm Kermit.
And how are you doing?
I'm good, man.
Good. This is a weird little setup for us,
huh? It is so different right now.
Why are we doing it here?
Because I stood you up last night.
I was heartbroken. I was standing by the door, dressed up beautifully, just waiting, and you never came. You never even called. I was thinking, at first, it was like, oh, he's running late, and then it's like, oh, maybe he got an accident. Something horrible happened. Then after a while, when you weren't returning my text, I was like, no, he ditched me.
No, I text you.
Yeah, I know. You text me like 3 days ago. Be like, hey, I have a chance to do a gig. And I did the thing where I ignored it and pretended like you didn't. And then you were back. You're like, so what do you think? I'm like, do what you want to do.
I was trying to get your opinion on it, and you totally blew me off. I was like, man.
No, it's all right, man. You know, I just got kids and a life and always clear away Tuesday night to make sure I passed up paid gigs for, you know, our podcast, because that's the faith I have in the show.
You
but
damn
whatever,
lie, dude. No paid
whatever.
Gig.
What'd you get paid? What'd you get paid last night?
A whopping 60.
Pat on the back? 60 Close bucks enough. And a pat on the back.
Pat on the back.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Good, man. I'm glad. No, I'm never going to stand in the way of you making some
it
money.
It was cool, man. I rode up there with Jeff Jones.
Mm-hmm.
So we just talked trash.
Yeah, he's a good guy, man. Take the Jeep or you drove?
Hell no, man. He's a dirty white boy. I'm not taking his Jeep.
I've ran the Jeep a couple of times.
No, I drove.
Oh, cool. Well, yeah, so good turnout for you. You were over at, you were recording someone else's CD, DVD.
No,
recording.
Devin was doing his second CD album.
Okay.
And now just opening.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, that's all. It's just a regular old comedy night. It's just he was doing a recording.
Okay.
So nothing fancy.
Did you get your stuff recording too?
No, of course not.
They couldn't even let it run a little longer.
No.
To get a good clip for you.
This table, number one, is so squeaky. And like, I feel like if I stretch, I'm touching you.
Mm-hmm.
This is so small.
This is after you just got done saying this table's perfect.
Yeah, and then I realized, like, putting my elbows on it makes a noise. And
it's not the studio back home.
It's smaller than the studio one.
It is.
And that's a small table.
It is. You know? But it is kind of cool to be here at the Orlando Improv out on the main stage right now. We got Jiggy performing, and it's a pretty packed out show in there. It's everything but the third tier filled last time I was in there. Jiggy, for those of you who don't know, he was an Orlando comic, started out in the open mic scene, caught a lucky break opening for the Impractical Jokers when they came through, and they liked him so much they took him on the road as their road opener. And now he's been in a couple of issues.
He's on comics?
A couple of issues of Playgirl. No. He's been in a couple of episodes of Impractical Jokers, stuff like that. Also on the stage tonight, Eric Myers is out there. Eric Myers, of course, Florida's Funniest, I believe, 2013.
How's everybody doing?
Hysterical guy. He's got an animated series you can find online called Court Order. And then, Ross Padgett's out there from, of course, Monsters, winner of the 104.1 Monsters Comedian of the Year from 2017, I want to say, 16 or 17. All I know is he beat me in my final round. So, you know, that's the funny thing with that Monsters in the Morning competition. I did it the first 3 years, and every year I lost to the guy who eventually won the whole thing.
Who did you lose to last year?
Last year I lost to Ross Padgett.
Oh, okay, yeah. What was the year that we lost together? Was that Ross? Ross. Okay.
Yeah. That was the year you decided you weren't going to do comedy. You were just going to go roast the entire panel of judges. You went all Tom Hanks punchline on everybody, like, and you hit your wife. Okay, I'm out.
It wasn't even a joke.
No. It was great, man. It was very.
Yeah, it was great.
And then on the other stage here at the Orlando Improv, over on the Fat Fish Blue stage, we have Carmen Falone hosting the open mic. They do it here every Wednesday night. Starts at 8:15 or so. So, yeah, I'd like to get this studio, like, yeah, this is definitely a trial for us tonight recording on location.
Yeah, it could work. I think we should have used the other table, but it could work.
Well, you know, you weren't here when I was picking out tables.
I told
you were running late. I did, and I thought this was the one that even said until you sat down, this is the perfect table.
I'm sure.
Those were the words you said.
This is a short table.
Okay, we will not use this table anymore. But let's get into it, man. I think last week we record on Tuesday night, because that's the time we set aside for recording podcasts, and we'd like to stick to it whenever someone's not being a bitch. But Wednesday night, we were both. Did you make it out here?
Yeah,
you were out here.
What happened Wednesday?
Wednesday night, it was the 8th year anniversary here.
Oh, that's right.
Orlando
that's right.
Improv. Yeah. So, 8th year anniversary, we had some great guys on the show, but I think Ken Miller had gone up. He was hosting the whole night. And that's when Chris Hispanic, the GM of the improv, came into the green room. She's like, hey, Howie Mandel is here.
That's
Does
right.
someone want to speak with him? And I'm like, what? And she's like, yeah, Howie Mandel's in the lobby. Apparently, he's filming Deal or No Deal down at Universal Studios this month. And he happened to be passing by, saw the improv, thought he wanted to come in and maybe do some time. I'm like, yeah, I think we can squeeze him on somehow. So I walk out to the lobby, and he's getting kicked out because the door guys didn't recognize him.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. yeah. So the door guys were telling him he couldn't come into the show without a ticket. So they were already halfway out the main door when I called him. I'm like, no, no. And in the door guy's defense, I didn't recognize Howie Mandel has a signature look nowadays about him.
The bald head.
The bald.
Glasses.
Glasses. You know, of course, we see him wearing the suits and stuff like that on Deal or No Deal or when he's judging. But you got to admit, he looked more like someone's 80-year-old grandfather who wanted to be a rapper.
He had a souvenir Brooklyn hat. Yeah.
Souvenir Brooklyn hat. He had those Buddy Holly thick prescription glasses on.
Basketball shorts
for some reason. There's not a court in 20 miles
not
of the improv. Yeah.
Hey,
Mike.
Thanks, Mike. Appreciate
thanks.
It, man. Cheers, man. Thanks. Yep.
That is a bonus of being at the Orlando Improv.
I
guess we get service.
This is what I like
yeah.
Already. Yeah.
This doesn't happen at your house. I mean, the girl cooks us dinner every now and then, but she's not coming into the studio with your beer of choice.
I'm going to make it now.
Yeah.
I'm going to make it. Hey. Beer me.
Yeah.
You
next
wench.
That's the next episode. And then the following episode, we're talking about what it's like to be single again. So, yeah, Howie Mandel comes in and, you know, he's like, yeah, I was thinking maybe I want to do some time. And we're like, okay, well, we'll put you up right now if you want. He's like, no, I'd rather watch the show for a little bit. So he watched for two or three comics and then came back.
Itch.
He's like, hey, do you mind if I go up now? And here's the thing that surprised me. I tend to remember Howie Mandel as being like a cleaner comic and everything
from
else.
Bobby's World. Bobby's World. Bobby.
And the voice of Gizmo, right? Yeah.
Yep.
And he went up there and he got kind of dirty.
He's super dirty.
He got a little dirty dirty.
A little. I was shocked.
I was like
all right.
Okay.
That wasn't on America's Got Talent.
Nope.
Yeah, it's super dirty.
Mm-hmm.
Raunchy dirty, too.
And part of the fun for me is having been a Howie Mandel fan before, like, he started judging America's Got Talent and everything else. I knew about his kind of OCD and germaphobe type thing. So when I met him, I walked over to him and I'm like, I shook the hands of the two guys he was with and then just kind of gave him like a wave. And then the comic right after me who knows Howie Mandel went up and tried to do this handshake thing and Howie like pulled back and was like, here, you can do
oh,
the
he
elbow.
Showed
him
the
he gave
elbow?
Him the elbow. Yeah.
Did you see Ken? Ken hugged him.
Oh.
And he was like, he's just trying to get away from Ken, and Ken kept holding on to him.
Oh,
and
man.
I was just laughing.
Know your comics.
Did you hear what happened to him at the open mic?
I heard parts of this, but why don't you go ahead?
So he came out after he did his set. Mm-hmm. Everyone rushed because he was nice enough to take photos of all the comedians.
Right.
And then he walked outside and watched the open mic.
Mm-hmm.
And he's watching the open mic. And I was trying to get up. I was like, look at me.
Right,
I did three
right.
minutes in front of him. I got a smile. I was like, but it doesn't mean anything.
Nope.
No. But before I went up there, there's a young kid. I think it was his first time. And he brought his family out.
Oh, nice.
And he went up and he did very well.
Like really well?
Yeah. So he gets off stage and Howie pulls him to the side. And I'm listening to their conversation because I got bumped one and then went up. So I'm listening to the conversation. And he's like, hey, I really like your first joke. I would like to buy it off of you.
Nice.
And the kid goes, thanks, but I can't do that. And he goes, why not? Because I copied it from YouTube.
Oh, and that's your...
So, and then like I kind of walked away.
Mm-hmm.
And then I could see how we kind of do like the finger pointing at the kid. Like, you can't, you know, do that kind of stuff.
That's a tough lesson to learn that way, that early.
And I can see the kid like getting destroyed.
Yeah.
But like a part of me goes, wait, is Howie buying people's jokes? Or is Howie knew that joke? And he was just testing that kid to see, like, let's see if this kid's going to admit that's a joke stolen.
I don't know, man. I mean, a lot of the bigger name comics, you know, hire writers and have writers. And, you know, like, even the monologues, the late night guys, they don't write their own monologues anymore. It's like they got a room full of 20 people
writing
jokes.
But he knew that kid was his first time. He said it on stage.
I heard the story, and I've asked a couple of people who were there. I'm like, that must have been a great joke. I want to hear the joke, you know? And at least the kid was honest about it. I mean, if Howie came up to me, I'd swipe the joke. I'd be like, well, you want to pay for it? And then when he hits me up like a month later, he's like, I saw that joke on YouTube. I'm like, some motherfucker took my joke and put it on YouTube? Yeah, 5 years before you were born. I'm like, well, that son of a bitch.
So that's what happened. I mean, it's cool. That was it. Then he drifted away.
Yeah. And I think we're missing the highlight of that night.
What part is that?
The highlight was, I think this is what you get. I think this is what I deserved. You know, I was on the show last week. You had done other bar. I had done other bar. You know, I'd done other bar. You did other bar. I was laying into you for doing horrible. Mm-hmm. I killed it. Yep. I did great. I went up at the Orlando Improv. My general rule is I don't put any new stuff into the show until it's been working really well at open mics, like locally for like 2 months or so, you know. But I was riding on a high after doing a couple of open mics with some new material. I'm like, you know what? 8th anniversary show. Plus the comic before me had gone up and just been insanely dirty. Like filthy.
Oh, right. Yeah,
and I'm like, I'm not going to go up there and open with my usual stuff. So I'll open with something a little bit harder, try and get them back on. And I think I guess it's the word that you guys use, bomb. Like, is that what it's happened?
No,
it happens so rarely to me. I forgot what it's like. No. Oh, I ate a dick for 5 straight minutes, man.
Just raining on you.
And you know the worst part? The worst part, and someone pointed this out after the show, they're like, you know the funniest thing? You look like you were enjoying yourself so much more than when you're killing. I'm like, I was. You know why? Because it's like what we talk about. When something happens that you're not used to, you're like, oh, this is new experience. I feel alive.
I'm mad I didn't see it. I was...
Oh, dude. I've got it recorded, the whole set. And the worst part of it is I haven't even brought myself to upload it to my hard drive to get it off my camera because I don't want to accidentally even see the first.
So wait, were the jokes bad or just the people were not like, because I heard your new material. It's mm-hmm. funny.
Yeah.
So it's just the people were not feeling you.
Someone said that when I went up there, I went up really aggressive.
Angry? I can see
and
that.
And I was a little ticked. Well, it was nice for Howie Mandel to stop by.
Do 40 minutes.
But it also ran the
hell yeah.
the show late. So the guy before me had done a couple of jokes about they were bluer jokes, like groaners, like going down on a girl during that time of month. So and then just as I'm getting ready to go up, I'm standing next to Ken, who's hosting, and we see 5 servers come out with the books. So I'm like, so I get eating.
Oh, you
out.
Got check drop.
I get check drop and eating out a girl on her period is what I get to call. I'm like, you know what? There's no one on this lineup better for this job, you know. And it was horrible. I went up a little more aggressive than I should have, and I made some mistakes. And you can get away with a lot in comedy as long as you're approaching it from a friendly, funny angle, or you have a little bit of likability. I threw my likability out the door in like my first minute. I think Ken told me Ken was like, you literally opened up with, you guys aren't going to enjoy this. And I'm like, yeah, I would. That probably wasn't smart. And then they didn't. So I guess I called it right. So I should get points for that.
Oh, man.
But on the bright side, I had 3 new bits I was working out.
I want to see your opener. That's all I want to see. I want to see the video of what you said in the beginning.
Yeah, we'll have to watch it.
I'm going to put it up on the YouTube.
The third bit that I brought, one of the newer ones, they hated me. Like, it had grown quiet. It wasn't even, like, loud chatty. Like, the comp before me was doing okay, but people were talking, and it was a long night, you know? With me, you know, the only thing worse than a chatty crowd is a crowd who's decided they're listening, but they're not saying shit. They're not laughing. Like, I took a rowdy crowd, turned them into listeners, but not like because they were hanging on every word. They were like, we hate this guy. Let's show him. Let's not even mumble because that might give him the idea someone laughed. And then the last joke of my new jokes brought them back to applause break. So I've never, ever, ever had a show where I was so deep in a hole that I'm like, this is over. And then the next joke brought them back to applause breaks. And I'm like, you know what? That's the keeper joke. If they fucking hate you, are already telling you, boo, get off the stage, and then you do a joke that brings everybody back together in unanimous clapping, imagine how well that joke would have done if I was already doing well.
Oh, man, I'm mad I didn't see that.
And then I closed with one of my regular bits.
Bring them back in home.
And then I did a merch pitch.
Of course. You better.
I love selling merch. Hey!
Come on in, bro.
Hey!
Come on. We got a special guest.
You want to come in? Come on in, man. You guys can share a microphone.
Come over here. We only got two mics. We're going to share this.
Yeah.
We got Ken Miller coming in.
Hang it. We would press pause, but that would mess up the video and stuff like that. Grab a chair, man. Come on over. Share a mic.
We got Robert over here. Magician.
Mm-hmm.
World class. We definitely got to get that board.
I told you that. I was like, man, where's the board?
I know.
So, ladies and gentlemen, into our new studio at the Orlando Improv. We just had Ken Miller. I believe, what were you, 2014, 15?
Man, I don't know. I don't claim it.
Florida's funniest comic walked in the room. He's actually at the Tampa Improv this Thursday night. He's headlining, and he is there Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Who are you working with? Who is it?
Clayton English.
All right.
All right, we don't know who that is. You know who that is.
Yeah.
All right, you made a sound.
No, I don't. I don't.
You really like, all right. I don't know who that is.
So, yeah, you know what?
You mean Clayton Anderson?
I'm gonna hang back. Yeah, we're always talking about having Ken in, so why don't you hit him up with some...
There you go.
Hit him up with some what?
Hit him up.
Wait, what are we supposed to hit him up with?
I don't know. Ask me something real quick. I'm going to go get on this open mic and do 2 minutes.
So when's that baby coming through?
Whenever I can make it.
Oh, okay.
Something might be wrong with me.
Yeah, it's funny because we were actually just talking about Ken's wedding last podcast.
Oh, we talking about how horrible videographer we had.
Yeah.
Pure garbage.
Yeah, y'all paid for that shit.
All right, cool, man. Yeah, we paid for it.
Worst wedding gift I got.
Worst.
And he got a knockoff popcorn maker, so that should tell you something.
Yeah, Jersey, your popcorn maker awful.
I thought Charlie Bowie got you the popcorn.
I got two popcorn makers. I took one of them back, and I won't tell the person who popcorn maker I took back.
Even after you just said Jersey, yours was horrible. Well, what was wrong with Jersey's?
It ain't like the other bars where the popcorn already made. I got to actually make the popcorn, bro.
And then put it in there?
Oh, yeah.
So it's like more of a popcorn holder.
So what I did was I stole popcorn from the other bar. But for some reason, that doesn't work in my popcorn maker. The stuff I stole
different
won't
work. Temperature.
Yeah, it just won't work. The bag and the oil stuff. But now I don't eat it anymore, so since I'm eating clean now.
Yeah, you on a cleanse.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. You gotta
like
cleanse.
Beer looks so good right now.
Look, he's not drinking. He's boring kid. Look, sober kid. Yeah. I don't know.
It's hard.
It's hard. You know, actually, the drinking isn't hard.
Yeah.
It's the snacking is hard. Mm. Not being able to eat like chips and cookies and candy. That's hard. The alcohol, I haven't missed that at all. But my kids are eating a bag of chips. I was like, oh, I can lick that finger, bro. Which is gross to lick your kid's finger. It's totally disgusting. Except for the 5-year-old. You can do 5-year-old. But the 18-year-old, that's kind of nasty to lick the finger.
You don't know where you're 18-year-old.
Yeah, yeah. Junior was up there itching his balls or something. His room door is always locked, so I know he's doing something disgusting, bro. He's always doing something disgusting. So, but yeah, man. So, Tampa this weekend. I'm 21. My goal is 21. I've been actually good. My wife is the one that's not been good. She's cheated like 7 times.
Time out. So she put you on it, but now she's already off the wagon, and then
she
stay up.
She's done it, but she's cheating, though.
Like a porno, bro. Like
yeah, she's cheating, though. Like I'm saying, like I've cheated twice because we went to the movies, and you got to have popcorn at the movie. That's just a thing you have to have. So we went to see Ant-Man and Equalizer 2, and I had popcorn.
You didn't
times.
Pay for both of those, did you?
No, I got movie pass.
Oh, okay.
Ain't nothing better than movie pass. If any of your listeners ain't got movie pass, they idiots.
I don't got that.
Bro, how many times you go to a movie a month?
Maybe once.
Okay, then you don't need it.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you go more, how many times?
Depending on the movie.
Well, here's the thing with Kermit. He goes to West Oaks Mall, so like for $10 a month, which is what Movie Pass is, he can see like 100 movies at the West Oaks Mall.
You can just go in every movie. They don't be checking at West Oaks. Yo.
No, even employees, when you walk into West Oaks, they're like, you sure you want to come in here?
Yeah. West Oaks used to be my date place. Yeah, I used to take girls there, but I was also... married at the time.
Nobody goes there. You don't take the good girl there.
But
right?
I was also married at the time. So I was like, yeah, let's go to West Oaks Mall.
That's the cheapest mall. You're not going to bump into
Hey, if my wife listened to this, I was joking. That was an old time for me, former time for me, yo. What's up? That's your list. You making a comedy album?
Yeah, man. So, funny story. I don't know if you knew this because I started down south. I actually started out as a guitar comic.
Well, yeah, Nat Bay Mel did too.
Yeah, Nat Bay Mel did, but Nat didn't really do original songs. He just played guitar while he did jokes.
Yeah, and it was awful.
And it was awful.
But
it was
terrible. I love him to death, yeah.
But yeah, I actually come from a background of playing in bands and stuff. So before I got into comedy, I was playing music. And then when I got into comedy, I would just start playing. All I did was play my stupid funny songs. And then I gave it up because I learned how to write.
And that's
a joke.
How many albums you got altogether?
No. The thing was, we were talking about it. What was it? We were after a show.
Mike whipped out a guitar.
After a podcast, I was playing the guitar one night after we recorded, and I was just playing some of the older songs, and he's like, dude, he's like, that's a funny song. And he's like, where have I heard that before? I'm like, you probably haven't. I wrote it. He's like, you wrote it? And then he went into full, like, Colonel Parker manager mode. He's like, we're recording this shit. We're putting it up on Spotify. He put it on his fucking Twitter feed and stuff like that. He's like, we're going to get some agents. We're going to get some money. We're going to do this. And I'm like, dude, I don't know how to do anything. He's like, you just write the songs. So then we joked about it. I told him I didn't want to do it. But now you know how it is, man. You got to put out everything. When you see these Instagram fucking guys taking shows from guys who have 45 minutes of material, you got to put shit
out there. I spent a whole road trip. I said, you know what? I'm just going to post videos of what popped in my head and just to see if it'll pick up some buzz. It didn't, but still, it was fun to do. Like, it was fun. Like, I actually had a good time, but it wasn't like a skit. You know, a lot of comics doing skits and stuff. This is just like, hey, like, I think the mayor is bullshit.
Right.
The mayor of a city is the worst politician. Like, what does the mayor do? The mayor is only important in Die Hard movies. Am I right or wrong?
It's the mayor.
The mayor's on line one. Like,
the mayor wants your badge.
Every
Bruce.
Time there's something bad happening in Orlando, you never say, call the mayor's office. That never happens. Only in Die Hard movies, bro.
You call the mayor, you get a voicemail that says, if this is an emergency, hang up and call 911. Because that's all I was going to do anyways.
Hey,
the
man, text me that. I'm putting that in my joke. That was fun. That's a good tag, yo.
Well, it's like, I asked you who was here last week, and it was two shows with DC Youngfly.
Yeah,
and I'm like, I've never heard of this guy. I'm like, is he any good? He's like, dude, he's got like a million followers.
Yeah, he got mad followers. He's one of the guys off of he started off as an Instagram guy, and then Wildin' Out, he went that Wildin' Out. It was funny because his Instagram video used to be one of my favorites of all time. It was called Battle Rappers Be Like. And then he did like this skit of like how battle rappers rap. And it was so funny. And then I'm telling like a year later, still had like 5 million followers.
Yeah.
Like, you know, but I guess I got that integrity. And I'm not saying anything bad about his comedy. I just got the integrity of that. I just like old school comedy.
We came up
and
different.
I don't feel like I had to get out there and do some stuff that's not what comedians did to get famous.
Right.
It sucks, but like now I got to, like Arnie Ellis used to say, I got to set my pubes on fire. Five stars, you know what I mean? Like,
but you know, unfortunately, it's a different time. Like the people we looked up to when we were starring out were the ones who told us, keep all your stuff offline because you don't want someone in Milwaukee stealing your jokes, you know, and don't do this and don't do that. And you got to drive to every shit gig across the country, and even if there's five people, you got to perform for them. And I feel like we're the middle children of comedy because that all changed while we were coming up. And now you can get famous without ever leaving your... Burnham had theater sold out before he even started doing stand-up because he was doing the YouTube, the songs, and everything else. And you watch some of his early specials, you can tell because he's never had to deal with a heckler. Like at one point, someone's heckling him. He's like, hey, man, could you please be quiet? I'm trying to do some comedy up here. You know, it's like because he didn't come up in the club. You know, type of scene.
It's so funny you say that. I was having a conversation with a comic. He went online and was talking. He didn't bash the comedy club, but he said something about a comedy club. And I said, well, first of all, that's dumb. If a club doesn't book you, don't, because you talk negative about them, that doesn't mean they're going to, you know what? I was wrong. Like, you've ever grabbed a girl in the club and she's like, you not touch me? You're like, well, fuck you, bitch. And then she turned around, you know what? I'm so sorry. Here's my phone number. That's, like, it doesn't work like that. So I sent him a person. No, first I commented on this thing. I sent him a personal message. I says, hey, I don't see you out much doing any shows. Are you still a comic? And he's like, nah, I was just doing these videos trying to get famous. Like, he stopped doing stand-up. He's like, I don't really do the stand-up anymore. I'm doing videos now. And I'm like, and that's the thing. They think that, well, hey, I ain't got to do stand-up anymore. Let me get these videos out, and then I get famous. And I keep telling comics it's the opposite. Get your comedy up. So then when you get booked out the videos, you can actually do 45 minutes.
Yeah, and it's easy. we can tell them that, but when they actually see people who did it the other way, and yeah, you might get booked every club in the country once or twice.
Yeah, but if you're looking for a
long-term career,
yeah,
you got to have the material to back it up.
I would say the one great guy, I don't know if you ever heard of him, who the hell is Ron Davis? He is actually, he was a comic that got famous off of videos. He is funny. Mm-hmm. Like, he's out of Charlotte. I know him from the Carolinas. He's actually funny, but he went our way. He was a comic, started doing some videos. Mm-hmm. He did a video about Odell Beckham Jr. in the club dancing, and it went viral. Mm-hmm. And then he just started getting mad followers. And then now he gets booked off. Now he did Sidesplitters, and Sidesplitters rarely books an urban act.
Right.
And he had Sidesplitters. So that shows his numbers are pretty good.
I was working the Funny Bone in Hartford probably about 6-7 years ago, and I was there for the weekend hosting for Shane Moss, but the off night there was a guy in there headlining. I can't remember his name, but the reason they booked him is he had a viral video where he was at a wedding and did a dance with his little 5-year-old daughter. Like, you know, the wedding dance thing was big craze, but they did it where him and his 5-year-old daughter had choreographed this little dance, and everybody was freaking out. It looked like it was done with a home video camera caught. And I'm talking to him, I'm like, dude, that's how he got famous off that. He's like, yeah, I got on Ellen because that video picked up, and then they interviewed me. And then he's like, yeah, we staged it all, dude. He's like, you need a viral video nowadays to get attention.
But it was even funny. but you know, and I was just in the office talking to the manager of this great club you guys are doing your podcast.
Chris Hispanic, we mentioned her
all
the time.
We were just talking about how her off nights are a lot of comics who are Instagram and internet famous. Yep. And you know, we're one of the rare clubs that actually locals get to do off nights.
Right.
You know what I mean? But for the most part, a lot of her off nights are like Instagram stars.
Because it comes down to butts and seats.
Yeah, butts and seats.
That's
you know, I tell comics, like, hey, man, I want to get a night to improv. Like, well, can you bring people out? Yeah, man, I can fill it up. Mm-hmm. And then I go check their following, and they got 200 people on their fan page. Or a video that they posted got 80 views. I say, well, how you think? When my friends will come see me, everybody say that.
Well,
bro, everybody has the my friends will come see me bullshit. No, they not.
I see.
And if it is, it's 10 people. It's like, I need 300 people, bro. Can you get 300 people in here? If not, then no, you can't have your own night.
And I try to explain to some people, and it took me years to figure this out. You can be funny as hell. They're not in the funny business. Most of these clubs we work aren't in the business. They're in the food and beverage business.
Food and
business.
Beverage, yo. They're in the business business.
The guy who used to book the hosts and the off-night shows here told me once, he's like, Mike, if we found out tomorrow that people want to see llamas, this place wouldn't be the improv. It'd be llamas, llamas, llamas. Yeah. We'd have 3 llamas on that stage, and you could pay an extra $15 to feed them.
Yeah.
He's like, that's all this
is. $5 for a photo op.
I think comedy managers and all those movies and everything get romanticized. It's like, oh, I discovered this kid, and I'm grooming him, bringing him up. It's like, dude, it's not like that.
Not like that anymore, man.
It's not like that. I've seen some very unfunny people get full weekends places just because they're recognized from movies, they're recognizable names, they'll get butts in seats, and no one gives a damn about your 45
We were talking about one act that's coming in, I won't say their name, and she was like, they're god-awful, but they'll be here soon.
They're god-awful.
They'll be here. But hey, people come see them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They come see them, man.
That's like that country boy that came. Remember we watched, and he only had the first tier filled up, then they had nobody in the second or third. And all he did was he would do videos of filming himself. Like, this is what I hate. I hate blah blah blah. That's all he does. And he did like 30 minutes. It was horrible.
Wow.
It was the worst stand up ever. Nobody was laughing. Nobody.
Everybody paid to see that.
Yeah.
Even if it was front tier, it still paid.
Yeah.
Like, our shows locally would be front to back, but nobody dropped a dime on a ticket.
Yeah.
Nobody dropped a dime on a ticket.
No, we comp it.
But there's people in here, man. But not to stop in, man. I saw y'all. I didn't know y'all recorded it here.
This is our first one.
Oh, right. That's why you asked me if I was coming tonight?
No, because the ladies were planning on something.
Oh, yeah. They're going to meet up.
Yeah, they're going to meet up. So
yeah, we got something special coming up. I'll email you about it tomorrow.
Yeah.
You already told them?
No.
Okay, well, you can tell them. We just can't say it on air.
Okay,
yeah.
You can say it on air.
Don't worry, no one listens.
And you ain't missing nothing.
Yeah. I mean, I'm listening to this.
You listen to this one.
I'm totally listening to this one. Yeah. No, I saw that. I thought those were like comedy albums because I was going through and realized I want to do a new one next year. And this will be my fourth one. I actually have 3. I did one when I first started. It was about 20 minutes. And then the second one was Allow Me to Reintroduce Myself, which was my feature set. And then the my wife and kids. I mean, my life and kids.
They play your bits on Pandora, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What was the one you did at the Crown Plaza?
That was allow me to reintroduce myself was first one. The Crown Plaza was the second one.
Okay.
And then this one, my life and kids.
Yeah. I was with you at the Crown Plaza. I wasn't on the show when you recorded, but I was there when you recorded.
I wore the same shirt every show.
And then I featured for you here when you did my.
So it's time for a new one, man. It's been like 3.5 years. I'm lazy.
Yeah,
I am. It's like you get comfortable with the material, and you're like, well, people love it.
So you're so smart because you actually recorded it. Like, I have stuff that I don't even do anymore from my feature set and stuff. And I wish I had recorded it when I thought it was funny.
Yeah,
and I look back. Do you do that? You look back at material you used to do and go, how did I do so well with such shitty material? So
dude, that set I got on YouTube.
Hard to watch.
Oh my god. Every comedian's like, I suck. I said, nah, watch this. Ken, it was so funny. I said, man, that. It was hacky.
Mm-hmm.
It was nothing to it. I said it killed because it was the improv. It was downtown. It had to be at least 400 people in there. It was like one of my first times doing the improv. It was a competition. Mm-hmm. I said, that's why. I said, man, if I did that set today, man, y'all would boo me up out of here.
Boo.
You'll boo me up out of here. But I said, but now looking back at it, I'm like, yeah, I know better now. Like, it's hard to tell these young guys. You know, we talk about in the green room, they have a 5-minute set of no laughing. Mm-hmm. And they were like, well, they paid attention. Well, like, they're really like,
if that was your job.
They like, hey, they paid attention. Can I get a guest spot at the Bonkers? Like, no. Like, the thing with this is to be funny. It's like, hey, you cook. And the cook brings out the food. You're like, yo, this is awful. Yeah, but I cooked it. Like, dang, bro, it's food on the damn plate, yo. Like, you should be happy and pay me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how comics are now. They're like, well, they were paying attention, and you know, that should be enough. It's not even about that's the thing that breaks my heart, because I've always wanted to do stand-up. Like, I'm passionate about. I actually really love this. Mm-hmm. And it kills me when I see somebody get up there and then they get off and they're proud.
Mm-hmm.
And they have not accomplished a damn thing. But then they look at me like I'm wrong because I don't want to let them host a guest spot.
And then when you say something that they don't like, oh.
Ann Miller is the bad guy,
the
yo.
Worse, MF, this and that.
Oh, God. Somebody told me, I heard a rumor I was racist.
Oh, that's a new one.
Yeah, somebody said I was racist because I didn't book white comedians. 90% of the hosts for Bonkers is white. white dudes, bro. So it is what it is, man. But y'all get back to y'all thing. Thanks for having me, man. I'm going to go ahead and steal 3 minutes because that's the only thing new I wrote is 3 minutes.
Right on. Well, Godfather of Comedy, Orlando.
Yeah, try out that mayor thing while you're out there.
the Capri Sound.
Oh, I love that joke. It's one of my favorites.
Ken Miller, everybody.
Ken Miller. Yeah. We'll have you back when we actually have microphones.
What's that? Oh, whatever. He's out of here.
Yep. Yeah.
Well, guess who else we got right here?
Hey, Robbie Moreland, come hop in the chair. Wow,
here.
We were just, look at this. What'd I tell you today? Hey, I told you yesterday.
I got topics,
man,
for no reason.
Work on the board. We want another microphone. Ladies and gentlemen, like to take a moment to introduce you to a friend of the show. This is Mr. Robert Moreland. More importantly, he's probably the finest close-up magician working Central Florida. Possibly Florida. I don't know every magician in Florida, but I can tell you he's in Central Florida. Mr. Robbie Moreland, ladies and gentlemen. Hey, Robbie.
Hi, guys.
There you go.
Thanks, Mike. No, dude, that was amazing. Like, you guys just had Ken Miller on.
Yeah.
So good. Like, you know, that's the thing. It's like, I idolize you guys here in Florida just because I love comedy. I freaking love comedy. And
but
like,
we're opposite on that. We love your magic because you blow our brains out, man. When we're out, because what happens is we go to the open mic every Wednesday and you come out after your show at Sluice. And then you just bust out sleight of hand? No. Mm-hmm. Close up. What's it officially called?
Well, I call it sleight of hand.
Sleight of hand,
I hate
okay.
Calling it magic because it just sounds so faggy. But at the same time, you know, it's like one of those things where, like, you know, don't get me wrong, I love the idea that people believe it's come on, like, really, like, we all know there's no such thing as magic, but at the same time,
I believe.
At the same time, it's not about magic. It's about the suspension of disbelief. It's about, you know, enjoying.
Can I just say? For a guy that comes from a lineage of people, men who wore handlebar mustache and top hats and capes, for you to come out and go, oh, they call it magic, sounds kind of faggy. Anyone see my sequin pants?
Seriously, though, come on, man.
David Copperfield was wearing ruffled shirts in the 80s. Come on!
And you know what the hell he calls himself? An illusionist. He never called himself a magician.
Oh!
I would hate for anyone to think I was gay.
Hey, come on, man. He's been sued on like sexual misconduct for like so many times. Like, I don't
know. No shit.
Oh, man. That guy's dealt with so many fucking.
Because he actually has a private island. I remember this story. One woman said that she went out there and he, you know, took advantage of her and stuff like this. And in court, the judge actually said, you went to a private island with David Copperfield. I believe it's international waters. I think the judge even said there's really.
What did you?
There's no better way to say, hey, that was consensual.
I'm going to fly you out to my private island to hang out only.
No.
I believe David Copperfield actually looked at the judge and said, how can I make these charges disappear?
You want to know something interesting about him? He's the first magician that's ever been considered a billionaire.
Wow.
Really?
Yeah. Like Forbes magazine did an article on him recently.
What about the other dude?
No, I'm going to tell you right now.
Yeah.
Like I hear all these magicians, they talk about, hey, I'm going to be the next Copperfield. I'm like, no, you're not. I tell him, I'm like, no, you're not. Like, I was like, yo, until you get an Emmy by the time you're 19 years old, you're never going to be
a... How old are you, 22? You've already
fucked. Yeah, you're done. Like, yo, sorry. You know, you might be you, but you're not going to be the next Copperfield. That guy fucking just, like, rocked it.
So how long have you been doing sleight of hand?
Since I was 14 years old.
Oh, wow. Man. So that's what, like, how many years? What's the math here?
God, I'm 39 now.
All right, we'll leave it at that. What's the math, Mike?
I'm getting up there.
All right, that's good enough. I was trying to shit on you because I'm not going to do the math. I'm horrible at math.
It's okay. He's been doing it for a long time.
A long time. He's going to leave it a long time.
More questions.
So you've been doing it for a long time.
Long time. Yeah. You know what's funny is the fact that, you know, I was so religious back when I got into this stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that a taboo thing?
Well, I was brought up in a southern battle. Dude, I'm from Savannah, Georgia. I live right outside of Savannah, Georgia, in a little town called Effingham County. Like, yo, and...
His first magic was making the knots disappear on the nooses. You know, like, look, now it's a noose. No, it's not. No, I'm sorry, but we are going to...
I'm line from Ralphie May. I'm my own first cousin, all right?
Oh, he's not with us anymore. You can take
it. I know.
It.
God bless him. You know, like, he was one of my favorites, too.
So, wow. And then... And then you've been doing that, so where else have you been performing throughout? I know you perform at a lot of places.
All over the place. I just got booked for a magic convention in San Francisco.
Oh, so how?
Wow. Although it still hasn't been announced, but wow. I just closed it.
Are you sure you want to call it a magic convention in San Francisco?
There's going to be a lot of magic there.
Maybe it's an illusionist convention.
Hey, I told you that's why I call myself a sleight of hand artist, is so I don't give the wrong impression.
For my next chick, I'm going to make my cock disappear. Who would like to assist?
You know what? I'm already researching like restaurants and stuff in that area, like and stuff. It's kind of crazy when you get booked to a place you've never been before, and I'm sitting here like, okay, so I'm gonna be doing magic and I'm gonna be hanging out with a bunch of dudes that do card tricks, and I'm sitting here thinking to myself, all right, I eventually have to get away from all of that because
do illusionist bomb.
Absolutely, dude. I ate a bag of dicks tonight.
Go on. Sleuth.
Dude, like, it was crazy.
It's going around. We just got done talking about my first 5 minutes here last week. I was like, bag of dicks.
Yeah, but you were trying new stuff. I saw your set.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know the difference, too. Like, like I eat a bag of dicks. I'm like, this is an unusual flavor. Kermit eats a bag of dicks so often. He's like, just like Mom used to make. All right.
No, you did fine, man. Like, granted, you were trying new stuff, man, and it was controversial shit, too. I applaud you for having the nuts sack to try it, you know?
Well, you know, when it comes to, like, what's a bar of candy, M&M or Skittles, you have to take a stance, and you have to be willing to deal with the consequences of that stance.
Absolutely. But I agree totally.
Back to you, man. San Francisco, you're going out there. Are you lecturing? Because I know you do a lot of lecturing.
And they want me to do a performance. It's a very small convention, 80 attendees tops.
Wow.
They don't allow anything else other than that.
Wow.
And it specializes in close-up magicians, which is my specialty. I love close-up magic. And I'm trying to kind of evolve to more platform-style stuff because the rooms that I'm doing now are starting to increase, which is a great thing. Mm-hmm. But when you're a close-up magician, the bigger the room gets, the harder it is to deliver the goods, unless you have like projection screens and shit like that.
Wow.
And I can't afford all that nonsense right now, you know? So I'm basically what I'm trying to do now is sort of, I guess, evolve into more of a parlor style performer.
only 80 attendees. You could do that show in a closet, which is where most magicians spent their early years.
I mean, illusionists.
Do you think they're going to add that to the LBGT, LBGTI?
Oh, my God, yes.
Lesbian, so gay, transgender, and illusions.
Yes, they're going to add an M right to the end of it.
Magicians. The M word. No, I get what you're saying.
Why do you guys think I hang out with comedians? Because I want to be better.
if you haven't, I don't think you mentioned it. Robbie has his own show locally over at Sleuth on Air National Drive, Sleuth Dinner Theater, Air National Drive. It's every Wednesday, starts at...
The doors open at 5:45, and my show starts, here's the funny story about that. I originally wanted to do an hour. In fact, you know, I had other people that were working with me. But really? At the same time, we were going to do an hour. We couldn't do an hour.
Why is
we
that?
We couldn't do an hour because they open the doors to the theater at 5:45. My show was supposed to start at 6.
Okay.
So you got 15 minutes to check in, grab a drink, get some fucking hors d'oeuvres, you know, so that nobody could get in the show in time.
Oh.
You know, so I basically said, you know what? We're going to start at 6:15. That way people can get what they need. Then get to the room, and then I can start the show. So we started doing that. Even that is, like, not enough time.
Damn.
So I basically had to take what would have been an hour show, and I had to condense it down into 45 minutes. So now I'm, like, rushing through all of this. But don't get me wrong. It's still a great show. I love doing it. But
so what,
I wish it could have been the original hour I had prepared.
So in those 45 minutes, you said you bombed tonight. How did you bomb tonight?
Well...
Did you like drop a
card? Like I said, I'm doing close up magic and you got people sitting in the peripherals. So it's like, you know.
I think I should point out your show is, in addition, Sleuth does it like a dinner mystery theater show where you sit, have dinner, solve a murder. Robbie's show is like a pre show to that, like an add on to the ticket. Adds quality to the ticket. So what they do is, you know, they have like an hour before the show. They're supposed to get their check in, then before they get seated for the dinner show. So he actually performs in a nice little theater called the Garden Room, which is, you've been there before. We do comedy there Saturday nights. Kevin White runs an open mic showcase over there. And I think when it comes to you, part of the thing too is people say magic show and they think, oh, the kids are going to love this. And that's not what you do.
No.
You're not a kids party, hey, where'd the handkerchief go type guy. You are sophisticated magic for adults.
Yeah, well, I mean, and in a clean way, too. You know, like, it's not like I'm doing magic that is, like, dirty. You know, I don't do, like, the bras and shit, you know, that you see some people do. I do magic that's sophisticated. I grew up on the classics. You know, the good magicians, the ones that were hanging out at the Magic Castle in Los Angeles. And I studied students that came from that arena. And when you watch sleight of hand at that level, it is like fucking Jedi Knights, dude. You know, like, they do stuff that looks just like magic, but they don't call it magic because they understand how gay that really sounds. So it's like... But they call it sleight of hand. And when you see good sleight of hand, there's no reason not to call it a magical experience. You know, like, it's one of those things that's...
And I watch you, and I tell people all the time, like, I've done comedy magic for a while. And I've always admired magicians. I've never called myself a magician because the difference is I know... Well, the difference is I'm straight. No, but I've never called myself a magician the same way that I get upset when I hear an open mic or say I'm a comedian. I'm like, you haven't earned it yet, you know? Like, I'm a practitioner. I'm a hobbyist. I enjoy it. And yeah, I've slipped it in to like some of the comedy magic when I do like casinos and stuff like that. But what you do is just so amazing. Like, I've always said, I'm not going to spend 20 years learning that move because I can buy a trick deck and do the same thing. However, that being said, when I watch you do tricks for people and they turn around and they're like, oh my God, he's so good because he's so quick. And I don't know where I read this, but it was about another magician, but I now put it fully upon how I refer to you. I'm like, no, the reason he's good is he's so slow. Like, people think all your changes and all everything you're doing, they're like, they feel like they must have missed something or he just moved too quickly. But I sit there and they call it burning. when you sit there and just stare mm-hmm. at someone, and I will burn, and I will have an idea of how what you're doing is working and still not be able to see it.
No, like when I was a kid, when I was practicing this stuff, I would practice, I would scrutinize myself in the mirror. And the reason I did mirrors because that was before I ever had a camera. And then I would get a camera and I would like point a camera and I would get it like right up to the point to where it was almost blurry. And then I would make sure it was still clear. And then I would practice the move in front of that. And then I would watch it over and over again. And I'd say that shit looks like terrible. But the idea is to create something that looks natural. Mm-hmm. And that way it sort of slips under the radar. And it allows the audience to sort of embrace it in a way. I really can't describe it any better than that. It's, you want it to look like just what would normally happen, but then all of a sudden, something miraculous happens.
Yeah. And
it's like, you know, you're like, where did that come from? You know?
I will say this. I think that's why close-up magic has always seemed more magical to me, because you see this stuff on TV and you see this stuff at a theater, and it's like, you can, if you're doing a show in theater as a performer, you can control the sight lines. You can use screens, you can use smoke machines, you can use everything else. To me, there's nothing more magical. I think this is why David Blaine used to get such good reactions. When would you agree David Blaine kind of became the street magician? Like,
oh,
David
absolutely.
David Blaine became famous for doing tricks that had been around. I was reading a magic book since fourth grade. Speaking of which, when I was in like elementary school and wanted to be a magician, I would go to the library. We didn't have internet. I would go to my school's library. They would have like 3 books on magic. I would check out all 3 at the beginning of the school year, and I would just keep renewing it. And this back when you had the little handwritten checkout. And I wasn't even working hard to learn all the tricks. I knew I wasn't that ambitious. I just didn't want anyone else to be able to learn.
Oh, what's going on? Hey, did you do something? Let me check the audio levels.
This isn't working. Hello, testing, test. Let me check yours. Testing? No, it's not it. Poop.
And we're sort of back. This is just Kermit. I'm back at home. As you know, we're recording from the Orlando Improv, and of course something happened with the recorder and the card went full, so we ended the show a little bit early. So that's what happened. That's why when you hear this latest episode of episode 25, it's gonna sound real weird. It's gonna be cut off real hard, and it is what it is, man. So apologies. We're still gonna We still got one announcement that we kind of messed up on. There's $20 hidden somewhere in Orlando, and Mike didn't give me the clues, and Mike's the only one that knows the clues. So there's going to be $20 hidden in Orlando for 2 weeks. Hopefully a homeless person doesn't find it and then ruins your guys' chances of getting $20. And with that said, that's episode 25 with Obligatory Podcast with myself and Mike. You can catch us on Spotify, iTunes. We actually have a brand new Instagram page. You can catch that Obligatory Podcast. And that's about it. So, and YouTube, of course. Apologies. It is what it is. And we'll see you guys next week for episode 26. Later.